Hello and welcome to today's European SharePoint and Office 365 community webinar. My name is Sarah McNamara and I'm delighted to be joined by Stefano Tempesta, who will be talking to you today about coded UI test automation of SharePoint applications with Microsoft Edge WebDriver. Remember to join in the conversation about today's webinar on Twitter. Our Twitter handle is at EuropeanSP and our hashtag is ESPC16. After the webinar, we will have a questions and answers session. Type any questions you have for Stefano in the questions window. Some questions will be selected and answered at the end of the presentation. This webinar is being recorded and you will be notified by email when it's available. And now I'm going to pass you over to our webinar presenter, Stefano Tempesta. Hello, Stefano.
Excellent. Thanks, Sarah. And welcome, everybody. Good afternoon. So my name is Stefano Tempesta. I work for EF Education First. I'm based in Zurich in Switzerland. Today's experience is a long experience, actually, on testing SharePoint applications using the coded UI test automation capabilities of Visual Studio, in connection also with a new Microsoft Edge browser, and specifically the WebDriver capability to automate functionality in Edge. So the agenda for today is relatively simple. The first half of the session will focus on having a look into Visual Studio and how we can automate test of the UI. And in the second part, we'll apply the similar principle, the similar concept to the new Microsoft Edge browser for the WebDriver technology. But before we go deep into the demo of the application and the test automation, let me just give a bit of context what are coded UI tests and where they sit in the entire application lifecycle of a SharePoint app, or in general of any software. Very likely you all are familiar with the different types of tests of a software, testing the user experience, testing the business logic, testing the data layer, access to data, access to information, presenting this information to the user. Now, in my organization specifically, a lot of this test is done manually, which takes a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of people involved in regression testing, functional tests, UI test, integration test, and so on. It works, but again, it's very time consuming. How we can improve it? Obviously, with a level of automation. There are tools for that, and they apply some level of automation to different aspects. Unit test is something that, if you are in the business of software development, you're probably very familiar to. Frameworks like Microsoft Unit or NUnit or similar frameworks help to automate unit tests. They focus more on the business logic, and a component of it come along for testing data, and that is more of connection between the business logic, the data access layer, and this is what we call integration test. Now, where do the UI tests sit? The user interface. This is what we want to test. We want to test the interaction of users with a screen, whether it is a web page or a WPF application or a mobile app and so on. It's really about the experience of the user. Right. Sorry for the glitch. We are back on track. So I was speaking about the coded UI test. They sit on top of the user interface. We want to test the user experience. We want to test the validation of forms. This can apply to testing the interaction of the user with, again, the interface, and in second level with the business logic and the data, or simply at the UI level by mocking, faking interaction with business logic and data. So the focus really is at UI level. So let's have a look into a few things. I want to show you an app in SharePoint that I developed for the European SharePoint conference in Vienna last month. Very simple. Hopefully you can see this well on the screen. There is a grid. It shows a number of emergency events that occur in some schools, a school in Cambridge, a couple of schools in London, and when they have occurred. Now, what I want to test is a filter. So let me say I want to test all the events that are in London. A filter applies, that's all I want to do. Alrighty, so back again from the beginning. Three events, one in Cambridge, two in two different schools in London. I want to test filter by school. That's my application. We keep it simple, obviously, for the sake of this presentation. Now, I switch to my Visual Studio, and I'll basically want to show you, first of all, a little bit how the application looks like. It's a SharePoint app in Visual Studio. There is an ASPX page that pretty much is a collection of web parts. What is important here is a reference to sps.js, which is my client-side object model to access SharePoint in JavaScript. And then the markup is a table with title, school, and start date, and a data binding using Knockout, and a couple of filters, filter by school, filter by start date. Now, I want to point you to two things here that we'll need later. The ID of the table is emergency event, and the IDs of the filters are filters by school and filter by start date. Simple as that. Just keep in mind, because we will need the reference to these elements by ID later when we discuss the testing in the Edge browser. From an application perspective, the access to the backend, so to my SharePoint backend, is done through the SharePoint JavaScript object model. I obtain a context for the client, so for the site where I'm running, for the application, because the app runs in a specific context within the site, and then I go through a number of queries against the SharePoint site to retrieve a list by title, so the title will be emergency event, and then load all the items using a camel query, so to retrieve a title, school, and start date, and then do a bit of the data binding using Knockout. I won't spend too much on the app. The source code of this application will be published after this webinar, so feel free to download it, use it, modify it. It's up to you to make practice with this application. What I want to focus instead is obviously the coded UI test. Coded UI are basically a specific type of project that you can create if you have Visual Studio Enterprise Edition. So there is a requirement of Enterprise Edition. If you add a new project, you will see there is a test category, and you can see a coded UI test project in there. I already have one for me, so I'm not going to create another one, but we can play with it. What is a coded UI test project? Well, if you are familiar with unit tests, is simply a C# class. In this case, I'm using C#. It can be obviously VB.NET. This class is marked with the attribute coded UI test. Similarly to unit test, you will do something like this. test method to identify a new method for coded UI testing, and the method has to be public void, and then you just give it a name. So we want to test filter by school. That's what we said. Here we go. I have a nice, let me close a bit of code in here. Here we go. We have some a method empty at the moment, ready for starting our coded UI registration. Why I said registration? Because this is exactly the way it works in Visual Studio. You double click, you right click, and select the generate the code for the coded UI test using the test builder. The test builder, now I will need to zoom out a bit, otherwise we don't see the screen. The test builder is this little object that you may be able to see on the bottom right corner, is a component of Visual Studio that will record all the actions that we perform on the screen, specifically in the browser. So let me zoom out again, otherwise we won't be able to see what I do. I start the registration, so start recording, and then any move, any action that I perform in the browser will be recorded. So what I want to do is go into the school filter, type London, tab, apply the filter, stop the registration. And here are the steps that have been recorded. Zoom in a bit. I type London in the filter by school text box. If you remember, that is exactly the ID of our filter, of our input element. And I also press tab to apply the filter. Alrighty, so let me reset the app so that it is ready for the next execution. Here we go. And now I'm going to generate code. So let me zoom in again so you guys can see that. I'll generate the code. Generating code is basically turning all the actions that have been recorded into C# code. And I will give a name as in filter by school. That's my recorded method. Generating the code, and now the code will be available in my Visual Studio. Here it is. So automatically, the test builder has created a method for me, added the method to the UI map, and then put the method obviously in the test method that I have previously typed. So what is the UI map? The UI map is a collection of elements that define all the objects, all the controls, and all the actions that are performed on the browser. We'll have a look into the map in a moment. What I want to do now is actually execute this test. So I'll close the test builder, I'll build my solution. Here we go. I open my test explorer, so hopefully, let me just pin it so it doesn't move. Hopefully you guys can see this clearly. My test explorer, there is my test in there, and now I run my test. So run the selected test. I zoom out so that we can see the screen moving. As this happens, and I put the browser on top, I just pause for a moment. I'm not moving, but as you can see, the test is executing in the browser and is running automatically. Now, that was very quick, right? So we have barely seen the action happening on the screen, which is good because at the end we want to optimize also the execution time for our test. And reducing time is part of the optimization that automation brings over a manual execution. However, because that was particularly quick, we may want to introduce a bit of delay just for the sake of observing how that works. So let me reset this up again, go back to Visual Studio, and open the UI map. Now, if you see here on this on the project, you have a UI map component. The UI map is basically a collection of all the actions that have been recorded within the method. So if you remember, that was our method, filter by school, and we type London and we type tab into the text box, and all the controls, the HTML controls that have been affected. In this case, the school edit control within the document, so this is the HTML document that is open within this browser. This is the window, the browser window. Now, we set delay, right? So I select the last action, right-click, insert delay. Let's do a couple of seconds, maybe. And here it is. I have a wait for 2 seconds between the two actions. This is also a way to simulate think time, which is basically what users would normally do in real time. When actually testing real application. If we now save this and close and compile again, so build again and run the test, we'll see that this type London waits for 2 seconds and then execute the filter. Here it is. That's much better. We have at least appreciated a bit what happens. And again, this is all being executed automatically. Now, let me reset the app so it's ready for the next execution. And you may be wondering, why am I resetting the app every time? The answer is, because I haven't played with the test initialization method. So if going back to our method, to our class, there are a couple of methods that are flagged as test initialize and test cleanup that are executed once for each execution of the test. In the test initialize is where you want to initialize your app. And in the cleanup, if there is anything you need to do after the test to release resources, connection to database, or anything that is no longer necessary, that's the place to do it. So test initialize and test cleanup are executed only once for each test. And test methods, you can have as many as you want, and they will run all in sequence as defined in the Test Explorer. All righty. Now, a few of you have probably done unit tests in the past and are wondering, where is the assertion? I mean, this wasn't really a test, right? This was a simulation. We had just played back recorded actions, but we didn't test whether the simulation was successful or not. So we didn't actually assert whether the test was performed successfully or not. We need to assert that the result is as intended, as expected. To do that, we need to look into the table, into the page, and identify a way to see how we can say that apply the filter London will bring correct results. So if you notice, this table has 3 rows and the header. If we apply London as a filter, it will bring this down to 2 rows plus the header. All right, so the way we can assert, one of the many ways we can assert whether a test is successful or not, is to create an assertion in the coded UI builder for the number of rows in this table. All right, so let me show you this. I right-click again, I go in my test builder. My test builder opens down here, and you will see there is this symbol that looks like a target. It's not is for a reason that looks like a target, because what you have to do is drag and drop on the controls. And as you can see, here we go. Let me select the table. All right, you see the table has been highlighted with a blue border. Now I can drop it. And here I have my table selected into my UI map. So if I scroll down a bit, I can see row count is 4. So 4 because there is a header and 3 data rows. So in total is 4. Now, what is the assertion about? The assertion is, if I filter by London, I would expect this to be 3. 1 for the header and 2 for the data. And in case it fails, it will say test failed. Alrighty. Given OK and generate my assertion. Assert filter by school. Add and generate. And if we go back to Visual Studio, you will see that now an assert method has been added to our test method to do the actual assertion. So this assert method will actually verify that the rows are 3. So the app is ready. I build again. I run my test. That will run the action, the recorded actions, and then do the assertion. If the assertion is correct, the test is obviously passed. And it is, in this case, the test has passed, because obviously we have the assertion correct. Now, I've been testing these only for a very hard-coded value, London. Can we make more generic? Can I test for additional values? Can I test, for example, for London and Cambridge? The answer is, obviously, yes I can, and the way to do that is to introduce data-driven test. And the way to do that is basically to add a data source attribute here, and then specify what is the data source to use. Visual Studio supports a good number of data sources. Excel, CSV is a typical and easy way of doing it. There may be a connection through ODBC to any database on the backend, or a SQL client to connect to a SQL table. To keep it simple, let's work with a CSV file. So I just create a CSV file, I add to my solution, I give it a name to the columns, and I enter the two values that I want to test for. London and Cambridge. Okay, so that's my test. That's my data source for the test. The data source attribute now needs some properties to specify what is the file to use. And forgive me, I will never be able to remember all of them, so I'll do a bit of copy and paste, and then I'll show you what it is. Obviously, you will find the documentation on MSDN, but basically, the data source attribute will say is a CSV file. You can find it in my data directory, school.csv. You can access sequentially, and another attribute, deploy item, because this file has been deployed with the solution. So I'm not accessing the file remotely, it is bundled with the solution itself. All right. Now I have a reference to my school.csv file. How can I modify my test so to use the data in the data source for my recorded actions and for my assertions? Very simple. Well, I hope it's simple. But what we have to do is basically is dig into the recorded methods. So if I just dig inside this method, you will see that I open an auto-generated code which is called uimap.designer.cs. So this file is a file, a C# file that is generated by the coded UI test builder. Don't modify it, because every time you record a new action, it will be overwritten. But what we need it for is to find a reference to the properties that contains London and the number 3, so that we can replace them and make a data-driven test. So if you see, this is our method, record method filter by school. And if you can briefly see, it has a reference to an HTML control. It type London into this filter. It wait for 2 seconds and then send the keys tab to the HTML control again. Now, type London in the filter by school. This is the filter by school element. Where is London? London is here, is in this property. So if I dig into this, here it is, my hard-coded London. So what I need to do now is to replace the value, the hard-coded value of this property with the value coming from my data source. So have a look at this. This is generated coded. This is the name of the class in the UI map. This is the name of the property. So let me just copy this, go back to my test, and before the execution, what I do is in the UI map, I reference this object. Within this object, I reference the control, the property, edit text. This is London hard-coded. I want to replace the hard-coded London with the value from the data source, which I can access from the test context. So I'm going to write test context. Text context expose a data row property. This is index property that you can call by name. That's the name of the column. It was cool in the CSV file. And then convert to string, and that's all I need to do. So in this way, when running the test method, this property that is used in the record method filter by school for the recorded action will come actually from the data source. So let me build, run the test, and see what happens. Here we are on screen. London is there, filter applied. Now Cambridge is there, filter applied. Okay, so that means that my record, my test has been recorded now, or actually has been played back twice for one recording. All right, let's have a look at what happened here. We have a failure. We have a failure, and if we dig into the error, you will see that there is the assertion, expected 3, but actually 2, failed. And that is for the second run. So the first run passed, the second run didn't pass, because we are still testing for assertion record row count number 3. We need to inform that there is a row count number 2. Now, before we do that, I just want to improve the readability of this output. If you see, this is an exception and is captured into the Test Explorer. It's very hard to read, and also it's very technical. I mean, it is just in there, into Visual Studio. You can't actually use it for alerting, for as part of a CI/CD automation. So I want to improve the way this report is generated, and maybe generate as an HTML file so that I can send also as an attachment to an email, for example, as a part of my test report, and inform the QA manager that a test failed. To do that, I need to add an instructions here for playback settings, and then I specify what I want to do with the logger. The logger, let me double check what I'm supposed to write there. HTML logger state, that's it. The logger should have a value all action snapshot, right? So again, this code will be available for download after this session, so you will find all reference in the solution in there. So by basically stating that I want to capture all the actions for the current playback logger, I'm informing the test method to record all the actions in a better format. Which format? Build. Let me see the app has been reset. Yes. And run. And let's have a look. This is now running in the browser. Here we go. London is there. Then we run for the second one. Cambridge is there. Beautiful. So let me reset the app. Go back. Failed as expected. But if now I dig into failed and I open the output is actually an HTML file. So let me zoom in a bit so you can see that. Here it is. There is an attachment as a file, and this file is actually showing me everything with the screenshot or reference. So it was saying me that I type Cambridge, I type tab, and the assert failed because the expected value was 3, but the actual was 2, and that's the screenshot so that I can see what it also failed. Alright, so we want to fix that. We want to make our test successful. And the way to do that is I open my CSV file, I add a count column, and I say for London I expect 3 header plus data rows, and for Cambridge I expect 2, one line for the data, one line for the header. I save this file, and now I go and inform my assert method to do the same. I dig into it, that's again the designer class, so don't change it, but as you can see, this is verifying that row count property is equals to 3. So 3 is hard-coded, and we don't like hard-coded. So if I dig into this, here we go, this is my 3 number that has been hard-coded. I need to change it. So I copy the name of this class, I go back here in my UI map, I reference the property, and this is the test context data row count to string. Now this row count is actually an integer, and I'm converting to a toString, so I actually need to do convert to int string. Here we go. That's better. And if I now build and run my test again, we test for London, it will test for Cambridge. Here we go. Oops. And now test successful, because obviously we introduced the correct assertion. Okay, all clear. Let's carry on with a few slides, and then we talk about the web driver. So this was the app. All right, a quick summary first. Use the coded UI test builder as much as possible because it will help you to record the actions. You don't have to type any C# code. It will do all for you. But do not modify the designer because the designer is auto-generated. Use it, have a look at it. It will give you invaluable information on what's happening behind the hood, but obviously don't change it. Every time you record a new test action, the designer will be overwritten. Now, a few tips also for optimization of this coded UI test. If you are running very complex user interfaces, it may take some time to execute. So try to split it down into multiple tests, rather for each page, typically, that's the rule of thumb. If you are testing an application that navigates the user through different screens or pages, stick to one test method for each screen. And it's better to have a smaller test rather than a massive one because execution time will take a bit longer. Also, if your application is extremely complex, so has not only different pages but different areas, so an admin area, a user area, a power user area, so something that changes according to permissions or privileges of access, or anything that is significantly different, work with multiple UI maps. Think of your UI map as your test area, and build one test area, one UI map, as many methods as you want. And the last tip I want to share is close all the instances of browsers and use only the one that you're testing on. And the reason is the test engine basically will look up for existing applications, for existing browsers application running on your computer until it finds the one where the actions have been recorded. If you have a lot of browsers with even multiple tabs open, the lookup will take a long time. And I noticed when I was playing a bit at the beginning that it may take 30, 40, 50 seconds to identify the correct browser windows before it can actually start playing back the recorded actions. So just close everything down and use one browser per time. That will save you a lot of time. Alrighty, let's move on. That was coded UI test automation in Visual Studio. We haven't seen the Edge browser in action yet. Now, you probably know Microsoft has introduced Edge as a revamp from the old-fashioned Internet Explorer, has removed a lot of the legacy support for ActiveX and other elements that are not really necessary and will create some security vulnerabilities, and has improved the overall experience from an internet navigation perspective. But what is really new in Edge is its programmability. So Edge comes with a set of APIs. They are all RESTful, JSON command-driven API that can control the Edge browser. So basically, by calling an API, by invoking an API in Edge, in the web driver, you can control Edge. So the way it works, basically, is you send an HTTP request with a JSON message to an endpoint which is exposed by the web driver, and then it will control the way Microsoft Edge browser behaves. Now, WebDriver is not a Microsoft technology. It's something that has already existed for a long time. And one of the more popular implementation was in Selenium. Selenium is very popular for automated testing. And the implementation of Microsoft respects exactly the WebDriver protocol, which is actually a W3C, a web consortium protocol, standardized for controlling the behavior of Internet browsers. Edge expose a rich set of APIs, I said, which you can find online on MSDN. I said is a W3C specification, and as you see here in the browser, there are a number of commands, a number of routes that are specified by our HTTP verb, so purely RESTful, post, delete, get, post, get, delete, and URI, which execute a specific command. So, what's happening here basically is you can build an external application, and by invoking this route, so this API with this specific verb, you are sending a command to the browser. You can open a new session, you can go to the specific URL, you can move back and forward, you can refresh the page, set the window size, find an element on the screen, get the attribute of the element, set the element, play with cookies, and so on. So all these commands are exposed by Edge and are accessible through the web driver. Now, it would be very difficult, or well, not difficult, but probably long to write all these instructions, all these calls to the API to invoke a specific command. There is a simplified way of doing it, which is offered by a web driver package as a wrapper around all these APIs. So let me show you this in action. Now we can close this method, this object here, because this was the old way of doing coded UI test, and we move into the new project, web driver test project. Let me show you what I have done here. I've added the Selenium WebDriver package from NuGet. This is a wrapper around all the APIs that we have seen before. And the way this works is basically very, very simple to what we have seen before for the coded UI test, but even more code oriented. So you will still do a test method in there. You will still give a name, public void. We say it was a test filter by school, but now we want to differentiate. Okay, so let me prefix this with Edge so that we know it refers to the Edge project. Edge test filter by school. Now, here, instead of using the UI builder, because that was the way in before to record actions, we use the NuGet package, the Selenium WebDriver, to invoke specific methods, specific commands to control our Edge browser. Alrighty. Before we do that, I just want you to point out the Edge driver is one of the drivers available into the Selenium package, but there are many others. There is support for Chrome, there is support for Firefox, there is support for Safari, and so on. So any browser that exposes a WebDriver API can be controlled by the Selenium WebDriver package. In our case, we want to focus on Edge driver. So I initiate an instance of Edge driver in my test initialize method. I need only once. And in the cleanup, I just quit the browser. I close the browser because I wouldn't need it any longer. All right, so in here, now I can start coding my automated test. And the way I do that is my driver URL. Sorry, URL is the application URL that is coded here, so is app URL. Then I want to get the filter by school. So my filter by school will be driver find element by ID. And if you remember, the ID was filter by school. So that will give a reference to the filter. Once I have the filter, I can do filter by school send keys. So send keys will actually send the instruction. And let's go for the hardcoded London for now. Then I want to sleep a bit, because otherwise it will be too quick. So I suspend my thread for a couple of seconds, and then I'll send the tab, which I obtains from this enumeration tab. Here we go. Send the keys tab. As simple as that. All right. So now I can execute in Edge this test. So if I just build this application, here we go, we have a new test in here, and if I run the test, it will open my Edge browser, open my SharePoint app, and run. We got an exception, so let me have a look what happened. It couldn't find the element filter by school. So let me have a look if I mistyped the name. Default ASPX is filter by school. It should be there, right? Filter by school. All right, let's try again and see if you're lucky this time. Connecting to my SharePoint app. Okay, I think it is getting a problem of authentication. So let me resolve this very quickly. If probably it is having a problem of authentication in the... here we go. It probably had signed me out before, so let me sign in again. Here the app. And we can now run the test. Should get better. No, authentication doesn't like. All right, so let me replace this like this and see if that works any better. Beauty of testing application live. All right, let's try again. Okay, seems like there is a problem of authentication with my SharePoint instance, and therefore the errors that we are getting is I'm not able to find such element, so it's not actually able to find the element by ID because it's actually not opening the page. Last try, just in case is a problem of delaying the page. I'll just give it a chance, otherwise we'll move on anyway and run the test. He's asking for authentication and he shouldn't. All right, there is a problem of authentication. Fine, we'll resolve this and publish an update later. Let's carry on for the sake of time. We have a few minutes and I want to open up for a few questions. So obviously we need to do also a bit of assertion here to verify that the test is correct. So the way it will work will be very, very similar. We need a reference to our table. So our table we need to find by ID, and if you remember, the name of the table was emergency event. So we have a reference to the table. Now we need a reference to the row of the table. So the rows of the table we obtain from the table itself. So we can find all the elements that are of type tr, right? So we'll say by tag name, and the tag name will be tr. In this way, tRows is a collection of all the TRs, all the table rows. So my expected count, again, we hard code it to 3 for now, and then we assert that R equals that expected the value from the tRows and the expected value, so the expected and the actual, right? Here we go. Expected count. Okay, in this way, we are adding basically a reference to the table, a count of the rows, and we are asserting that the two are equals. If we want to make this data-driven again, we will do exactly the same as before. We have our school CSV file with the schools and the count, and we'll basically replace this hard-coded value with the actual value coming from the data source. So again, I take my data source attribute exactly the same as it was before, with a reference to school CSV. So nothing has changed as seen before. Instead of hard-coding London, so here we'll do something like the school name is coming from the test context, data rows, school, to string. And then, obviously, instead of sending London as hard-coded value, I send the key school name. And the same for the expected count. So the expected count, instead of being hard-coded to 3, it will be my count here. I need to convert to int, because obviously is an integer, and then we do the assertion exactly as we have seen before. The difference really is that we are now controlling our browser using commands in the Edge driver API. And that's pretty much complete the presentation. A few pointers. If you want to see a bit more about UI automation in Visual Studio, that's the URL. It will redirect you to MSDN, and you can take it from there. And the reference to all the APIs, all the commands in the Edge web driver, again, on the URL on screen, slides will be available also later for download, and then you can take inspiration for all the commands that you want to execute. We are really at the end now. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for listening. I hope you appreciate this session. I open up for a few minutes of questions. Happy to answer. And obviously, reach me out on my Twitter or my blog if you have a further question after this session. I enjoyed doing this session. Hopefully, you have as well. And again, if you have any questions further, just contact me. I will be happy to discuss directly with you. Thanks, everybody.